Street, and great pleasure to welcome you here today to the 150th anniversary of the Tram in Bendigo. We're very much pleased to be here today, not only in Bendigo, but for Red and Joy, because we are my father's longest operating depot in England,
and they established a Tramway system between Bendigo and the world. The district here, this little tram, is a wet battle, still being built, top of the factory tram, so brown backwards, and it was imported from England to do that job. Didn't mark really on the trail, because the batteries, obviously, real life technology is there today, and they made that option the tram had to be helped out by a couple of hefty horses to get it back home and keep it moving. So after 6 months, closed down, and a little bit later, imported and ran steam trains in Victoria. So we ran steam trains for about 12 years until 1903. If you're here, gentlemen, anything over $2 is tax deductible, so we'll get you a receipt. Thank you.
Quite a bit. This is just the front of a tram. You can go and sit in if you want. It's so Sydney 100 years ago. Spent most of its early life in Melbourne actually. Mm-hmm. Then went to Ballarat for 30 years and came to Bendigo in 1960.
Set a track.
Well, Queensland said we got it.
Puss.
600 volt DC.
Is that efficient for today's modern motors?
Thank you.
just about any gutter you could pan for gold. But all the kids knew how to do it too, because their fathers had taught them. They used to do well out of it, enough to buy drinks, lollies and comic books. Those that came from large families would give a bit back to their mothers. Paved roads and sidewalks have since transformed the city into a much more livable place. Before these improvements, when the wind blew, there was sand everywhere. People couldn't keep it out of their houses. You ate sand, you drank sand, and you slept with sand in your bed. Then there was the noise of the stamping batteries crushing quartz at the gold mines. They pounded away day and night. When they turned them off on Saturday nights, silence was new. The gold rush attracted people from far and wide, including thousands of Chinese.
The passengers who have just joined the vintage floating tram tour, welcome aboard. Our first trams were operated by the Sandhurst and Eaglehawk Electric Tramway Company and began running in 1890. They were powered by electric storage batteries and were supposed to have enough power to run 30 miles, or almost 50 kilometres. But often, they took its toll on the Bendigo Tramway, and by 1942, the number of men available to work had dropped to the extent that the tramways announced they would employ the wives of servicemen as conductors on the trams. With very little response from married women, it was decided to opt for them to single. By the end of the war, there were 22 women employed on the trams. However, they had to relinquish their position when the men returned from service. We're now turning into Bridge Street, one of Bendigo's oldest streets. The area along Bridge Street behind us, near the Golden Dragon Museum, used to be the centre of Bendigo's very own Chinatown. During the gold rush, thousands of Chinese walked hundreds of miles to Bendigo, after first being unable to make good necklaces. It seems like heroes to Bendigo in those days. Apart from gold, Bendigo is famous for its tree-lined streets and is sometimes called the City of Trees. Ironically, during the gold rush, the diggers chopped down just about every original tree. But with no shade, the new township sweltered during summer. The early council began planting trees. Most of the surviving elm trees you can see are more than a century old. A lot of the long-serving drivers and conductors got to know their passengers very well. Often they would have seen them grow up, travelling by train to school, then eventually work, then through their courting days and marriage.
Wondering why Bendigo's modern tramway Thank you.